certainly kind of busy. But please contribute as fully as you can, because you feel able. Have you got any apologies for absence? I haven't had any.
We have cheered that. Apologies from Council Paul Hayes, Councillor Alan Drake House,
okay, can I ask you to look at the minutes of the meeting that was held on the 23rd of March? And I ask you to agree there's an accurate record. I think there was a slight problem in Councillor Roberts.
Yes, I was here.
In fact, I think we came to the conclusion upstairs that John Salter replaced Trina and Johnson. Right. Are you happy for me to sign those anyway? Yeah? Very much. Right. The next item on the agenda is the minutes of the attainment subcommittee. That's item 3. It's purely to ask you if you agree there's an accurate record of you were there at that committee. There is more information on this on the attainment subcommittee later on the agenda, but for this moment, would you just agree that there's an accurate record of the meeting on the 4th of March? Are we happy with that? Yeah? The next item is the healthcare fund panel. Need the notes taken from us on the first page. That was another full agenda when we looked at the action plans for the Cornwall University teaching hospital improvement plans for them. We did a lot, they were very cooperative. We had Evan Moore, Joe Galvani, and Jean Quinn came along and answered our questions as helpfully as they could. We also had another meeting where we looked at the quality accounts for the different health providers and made our written submissions on that to accompany those to the government. We were given the work programme for the following year. Can I ask you that you bring those to their, that they are accurate with that what happened in 10 minutes, but they are to agree back. Item 5 on the agenda tonight is the performance management report that we get on a regular basis, and I'm going to ask Claire if you would like to introduce that. Yes.
This is the end of the report on the director's performance against the 57 indicators that were in the performance plan. 56 of those indicators were rated as green, 21 were rated as amber, and 11 indicators were rated as red, whilst 2 indicators are currently unrated in terms of information that we're waiting for 1 of the indicators. And the second indicator was a local indicator that linked into a national plan which is seems to be withdrawn, and therefore it was difficult to get the analysis. Of those 11 indicators, 60% were annual measures that are related to school attainment or to the annual survey, or to the annual survey, or the annual survey. Of those 11 indicators, 4 of them have been regularly reported to the committee, so the smoking, quitters, and the proportion of opioid drug users have been on the agenda of the committee. As at the time of the adoption of the committee, and the average number of bed days has due to no transfer. There are 5 annual school achievement indicators, which are never been subject to scrutiny or be told the committee. Surveys in terms of satisfaction of carers and the proportion of people who use services who found it easy to access information. And the action plans in relation to them, all of those indicators are shown as an appendix to the body of the report. So I'm not going to say anything else, Chair, but
I was remiss at the start of the meeting that I didn't ask the declarations of interest, and I know one of my members would want to make a declaration of interest.
Yeah, Chair, I'd like to say that I'm going to enjoy you. And I have a personal trust in agenda
item 5. And I also didn't ask everyone to verify that they're not being subjected to the party whip. So apologies for that. want to ask questions on performance indicators and that under the inspection report. Yes.
Thanks, Chair. It's wonderful smoking committees. We do know as you can see that this is sort of parents inclusion. And I said before and I'll say it again, I'm very concerned that the targets that are set centrally are just not achievable. It was mentioned e-cigarettes and potential explanation. Is there an argument to be had for changing how things are measured, or because I don't think we can change the targets? I just think that it's here this often that the parents start looking at this in a different way. I think e-cigarettes, and we spoke about this, they may be a major part in this area.
The smoking target is set locally, so it's not a national target. We have, because of the performance, taken a decision to move the commission services around stop smoking because they're not delivering what we want, and we do need to see redefined targets as a result of the impact of things like e-cigarettes, and we have discussed this quite actively in this committee in terms of the impact of that on the cohort. We believe are still there to be targeted through our stop smoking services. What we're proposing to do is to be perhaps more realistic about the target that we set, given this new introduction of a new of e-cigarettes into the marketplace and the impact that that's having. So we're calculating the numbers of people we could believe we have smoking. The numbers we think might well take up the cigarettes offer, and then looking to set ourselves a realistic target from those who are left, but also trying to make issues simpler and deliver slightly differently, because what we've got now might not be fit for the purpose that we might be going forward. So as a result of this underperforming, I think I've said in previous committees, if it continues to underperform, we would look very seriously at bringing a proposal for the commission to a different way, and that will be coming to July cabinet for a decision.
Just to come back to it, sorry, I apologise, but I was told that the target was section.
Dave.
Thank you, Chair. I've got two questions in my mind. The first one's on 17, the achievement gap between pupils and through school meetings. I can see that there's a slight improvement in the figures there. Has the pupil premium been able to help move this target, and we'll be looking to improve on it? That's the first question. That's the second one. And the second one is in relation to number 45, we have this monthly bed delays, cost using the rail transfer. There is a lot of information in the response and the comments. We have an aging population, are there any actions being put in place to make sure that these don't escalate as the aging population increases?
Okay, I'm speaking about key stage two. The actual gap was closed in respect of reading and maths. Just writing where the gap has got wider for children, and this is a measure of all three of those indicators taken together. And the gap has reduced overall on the previous year, but we've not closed the gap in the way we intended with the target. The pupil premium is making a big difference. Schools have to publish how they're using their pupil premium, and they are regularly challenged on that by school improvement officers, but also we expect each government body to challenge how the attainment of their children in receipt of school free school meals is improving year on year. There are a number of children in primary settings where they're not claiming free school meals, and that's something that we're actively promoting. Take up is up to 100% wherever possible.
time now has been commissioning services in different sorts of ways. So we commissioned the domiciliary care sector, and we worked with the residential nurses in order to enable more responsive reactions to people's needs. So in our own position, we've been able to organise domiciliary care packages same day, one assessment needs and all those sorts of things. So much more responsive system. In terms of the current situation, then we are one of the leading authorities in terms of late transfers of care, and doing much better in most areas, but it's still not good enough. We work very, very closely with teams at hospital. We have an integrated discharge team. We are due, we've just gone out actually to commission an additional 40 beds, step up, step down types of beds, transitional care and intermediate care beds, because we do recognise that capacity in the market is required in order to enable people to step down from hospital. And we've been working very closely with AHUK in relation to a home from hospital service. It's enabling people to get home some support in relation to making sure they've got the basics in place. So we continue to work on the pathways, we continue to work with colleagues across the system to improve things. It's important to say that our vanguard work with the NHS as a whole is focused on supporting people more effectively in their own homes, and we've been developing integrated community care groups. Given exactly what you've raised in terms of the increasing population, then it's really important to get the services working together as effectively as they can, because we don't want people stuck in hospital and they need to be there. But we also don't want people going into hospital that they don't need to go into hospital in the first place, for the reasons.
In fact, when we come to the item 12,
I'm
looking at the work programme, that is the next major piece of work we're going to do. And one of the spotlight sessions which will be open to all members of the council is on vanguard status. So thinking children are safe
being really looking at the time when some children leave for adoption, and also promoting special guardianship when children leave care by being more securely attached to special guardians. But we still have a big group of children in the 670 that we have this week who have been looked after for too long. Now, our next step that we've taken, and we took on the 15th of June, was to implement the reorganisation of children's specialist services. And one feature of that, which has been designed by children and by workers, is to set up four children in care teams. So there are two teams in Birkenhead, there's one team in Wallasey, and there's one team that covers South and West Wirral. And these are teams of dedicated social workers who focus on children in care and make sure we progress their plans to achieve permanence where possible out of care through adoption or special guardianship. There will always be circumstances where being in care for a period of time is right once we get safe plans for them to move through, and perhaps older adolescents remain in care until they leave. But we anticipate we should have a group of about 450 children looked after, not 670. So what has happened hitherto is our assessment and care management teams have had social workers, we've had a caseload of child protection and court work and in assessments of children. And with the best will in the world, with a caseload of about 25 children, what's happened is children safely in care placements, and the majority with foster carers, they have not got perhaps as much attention to progressing their plans as having dedicated teams would give them. So we're hopeful with the early help offer, which we're continuously looking at and strengthening, and the family, intensive family intervention and troubled families programme, which is shaping our learning and partnership working, and our dedicated children in care teams that are taking shape from the 15th of June. We will be in a much better position in supporting that reduction than we have been to date.
I think Claire just wants to make a recommendation.
Sorry, it was a general comment.
Yeah. Is that right?
Yes, because you sorry about that, you have another comment.
I think that's grand, and I just look forward and hope that we see anything we should work to. That's very challenging.
I just wanted to question if I might share.
That's okay. It was just regarding number 55, which is about scheduled lodgings, visits to residential homes. And it's not really about the lodgings, it's about the problems on the right-hand side, which gives us a proportion of homes rated as green, red or amber. I think it would be helpful to the committee to know whether that represents a movement or whether that is a sort of static proportion.
In terms of information, I think there's agreement that we provide the detail of the business in terms of the in terms of evaluating for adoption. We've got recommendation to the contracts team and their role in terms of approval quality residential care. So I'm very happy to provide that information in some detail now. But it's something that we think fits with the performance of.
It does, yes, and actually I have been asking for, and I've received, I have to say, the regular round rating of different homes, and we've actually started sending those out to members of the board where homes are starting to perform significantly lower to the members group. All members are getting to know that network, so that's important. Before I bring Claire in, I think I probably need to move the discussion into the direction that we had a coordinating committee the other night, which for me was sparked by understanding that Wirral's number of accommodated hospital admissions was fifth worst in the country, and realising that that hadn't appeared on a performance indicator in the committee. And that caused me to start wondering whether or not we were seeing the right information, whether the information we got. Whether we know what we're asking the right questions, basically, are we as elected members understanding what's happening in terms of performance? And that's not to say officers don't, because I'm sure you do. and I think the conclusion that came out of the discussion was that probably we could develop things in a better way, but we're not quite sure how to do that. It was suggested, and I think it was accepted at committee, that we have a quality training session, but a session for elected members whereby we can discuss how best we can get information which reflects what's happening across the areas that we scrutinise. And so that will be included, I'm sure, whilst the request goes to the training subgroup in the training programme for elected members this year. I'm interested to hear what members of this committee think. I doubt you would not agree with that, but there's always that uncertainty. Are we seeing the right information? Are we understanding what are the right questions to ask? Wendy, you've highlighted the fact that we picked it up tonight. There's a trend there, but we don't always see that because it doesn't come in as an exception report. There's a bitter of example, for example, the exception reports come through in some cases more than one of them year after year, and they're not actually even the wording's changed. It's not a criticism of anybody, it's really aimed at allowing us to do what we need to do. So I think that training session will take place sometime in the next few months, but that's just my comment. I'm not sure if anybody in the committee wants to comment on that, on my part, my interpretation of how members might be feeling insecure about the data that we get and our ability to properly look at their performance. And I'm happy to have that. Okay, what's the general question?
So, general question, thank you. I think about the end of term report indicates that the complexity of the environment that we're dealing with and the real ability for this agenda to move around very, very quickly in terms of our areas of focus. And given the background of over £20 million being taken out of the directorate over the last year, I was pleased to see that we have made progress in the majority of areas. Clearly there are some areas that we do still need to focus on. And taking your point, Chair, about some of the indicators that we have linked to national frameworks, they are quite focused on process and so on. I think it's really important that we do move to a much more outcome-focused performance framework. And now that we have the council plan that will be going to council, policy council, in July, which is very much focused on outcomes and being able to demonstrate impact, I think that will be really helpful in terms of setting up a new framework.
Concern that might lead to a pathway of something taking out an easy breath.
if it's still considered that they are smoking, I think some of the research then that should show up. If still have to go to the sense of having it, so that shouldn't actually be one of the bits, which is true. That bit is true. I think if any of these people say have it, they've just changed the way in which they're thinking.
Thank you.
The
way the FCC has been working with the So the
will receive a couple of nights a month, or some children have needs and families have needs for a slightly longer break. But there are 58 children in total who have varying amounts of time at Wellbeing. And these children are not counted as looked after because of the numbers of days that they actually get support at Wellbeing. And the report sets out how there is an array of different staff, residential childcare officers and night care assistants, who between them provide 24-hour care for the children when they're staying at Willowtree. It's important to say in 245 that Willowtree is actually rated as outstanding runoff stay in June 2014, and that was endorsed in March 15 this year. So an excellent manager leading a really good service. Paragraph 2.5 sets out another aspect of our children with disability service, which is the family support service. And the family support team provide support for 39 families. And this is either planned support or on occasions emergency support. And I think it's fair to say that both the short breaks and the family support are provided in a multidisciplinary context. So there's quite a bit of input from psychologists, from Cheshire and Wirral Partnership, who have occupational therapists that work with the children, work very closely with the special schools. So it's a multidisciplinary approach for the 58 children and the 39 children. Now, I think it's important to say that some of these aren't the same children who have family support when they are at home with their mums and dads or carers, and who have residential care when they're actually staying in Wellbeing. And the proposal in a nutshell is to have a single workforce that would work to support children when they're having the short break within Wellbeing, and then work to support those children, some sort of different, actually tell them numbers, but support the children when they're at home with their families. And because we've currently got a separate family support service, there are times when it's a waste of having a full-time worker. There's in effect downtime because children are all in school in our special schools within Wirral, and the family support work takes place in the evening or sometimes early in the morning to get children ready for school or to do support work. Evening or sometimes at the evening. So the plan is to providing excellent family support and residential. more generic wording, restructuring potential reduction in signals and the review of contracts, rotors, and expecting greater flexibility. It's clearly during the school holidays with the children who will be needing short breaks, so I guess that we're going to be more full during the school holidays, but families at home with children who need support during the daytime. So we're looking at that flexibility, prospectively banking hours to call people in during the peak times when they need the most. The thinking through that has been done by the senior manager and the registered manager is that this can be managed with minimal impact on children and families. And our next step will be to start a consultation process with children and families during July. We've done a broad council-wide consultation, but we need to talk to the families of the 58 children and however many of the 39 additional children. We need to talk in depth with those children and families and make sure that we have a one-to-one consultation as well as information we give out to the consultation groups. That will achieve, the proposal will achieve $350,000 in savings. We have already banked $254,000 in savings that we are definitely going to achieve this year of the $600,000. And you'll see
is a
change that is being made this year, and we are not working on the basis that we need to fill those vacancies. They are, the two social work vacancies are not in the short break in family support service. So they are vacancies, and looking at the caseloads within the children with disability social work team, we've formed a view based on how we're meeting those children's needs that we can manage without those two posts. So there are savings that we can achieve this year.
Then I think you probably do this up a disservice by putting it as a total, because anybody who you report will clearly see the desire or potential that you keep. And I notice that 350,000 is not going to get on anything this year. So do you know when that would be achieved? Give us a timeline as to what you think 350,000 will be done, because it says it won't be done in this financial year in full.
We're working on the basis that the 350,000 will be achieved from next financial year for full year effect. So the 603,000 will be a full year effect. We're still working on the timeline. We want to do the consultation over 6 weeks, starting in July. And then we need to do the staff consultation. So I'm very happy once we've done that to feed back with a clearer timeline for this financial year.
It's for noting. I'll come to note this. I'm sure we'll come back and cover this at another stage. Item 7 is a verbal update by the Chairman on the Health and Human Report. And I'm told that noise, which we're all appreciating, is practice for an event on the river. And it's practice, my comments practice, they need to do a bit more.